we have to. Is there anything else there? There's a...
Full of sound and light and expectation. This day has been waiting for you. This day has been waiting especially for you to embrace you, to guide you. This day has been waiting with open arms just for you. This is the day we have been given. Let's not waste it. Come now and let us worship together. Good morning, everybody. My name is Reverend Joseph Boyd. We are streaming live from 1105 Elm Street in Youngstown, Ohio, one of the best cities in the entire United States. We welcome you in the Mahoning Valley, Trumbull County, parts of PA. We welcome you across the United States, spanning from California to New York City to Colorado, to other parts of the globe, the Dominican Republic, Brazil, and others. The list just keeps growing. All of you, welcome into this sacred space. For over a century, this church has rested here on the north side at the cutting edge of a community seeking justice, centering the marginalized. We have raised a Black Lives Matter banner at the front of the sanctuary facing the street on Elm Street for all traffic passing by to remind ourselves and our community that racism and systems that support racism must transform if we are to become the beloved community. We have waved proudly a rainbow flag to signify this place as a sanctuary for all LGBTQ+ persons. And now that we are completely virtual, we have made that available to the entire world as a sanctuary, as a space to reflect, be, and find inspiration for bold action. So speaking of the LGBTQ community, we have a LGBTQ committee that organizes services throughout the entire year, including Pride Month in June. So there are many events coming up this next year, including Coming Out Sunday on October 11th, Trans Day of Remembrance on Friday, November 20th, February is LGBTQ History Month, Harvey Milk Day on May 22nd, and there are just so many events throughout the entire year, and we're looking for members for that committee. So far we've had a core group of about three or four that have kept the committee alive for many, many years, and now that we're virtual, we're looking for anyone who would like to participate in any of the events in the upcoming year and help shape what those events look like, including partnering with the community. And again, now that we're virtual, that community can be in every state across the United States and even across the world. So if you have connections where you are in your local community, even outside of Youngstown, and we'd like to bring them into the sanctuary, please put in the chat box your name and LGBTQ And we'll know that we can add you to our email list, and we can connect with you and hear some of your ideas about how we might shape the next year in this beautiful virtual space. I'd like also to announce that on Saturday, August 15th, that's going to be this coming Saturday at 11 o'clock, I'll be facilitating a conversation called Actions of Hope. I was recently inspired by an article in Vox. It was an interview with the public intellectual Cornel West. And he said something that really resonated with me. He said that if we wait to feel hopeful before we take actions of hope, that hope may never arrive. But once we take the actions of hope, the feeling of hope can come. So that's the conversation I want to have with any of you who'd like to join. It'll be using this very link next Saturday, 11 o'clock a.m. Eastern Standard Time, to hear about how we might brainstorm what those actions of hope might be, both personally for ourselves and also for our church community and other communities that we're part of. So please join me for that conversation. That'll be this coming Saturday, 11 o'clock, using this worship link. And now I would like to go to California, where our Director of Religious Education, Mystery Wallace, will introduce herself and introduce the lesson plan for this Sunday at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Mystery in California, let's zoom to you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Mystery Wallace. I'm the Interim Director of Children's Religious Education. And yes, I'm in California. It's pretty early. So this summer, we have been studying living things. We started by defining a scientific definition of what makes something alive. And we have looked at all different sorts of cells and creatures. I picked this topic because humans often believe that they're superior to other creatures and themselves, and even other humans. It is very important to remember that we all have the same roots, and everything we do affects other beings on this planet. Today, we are having what I consider to be the most important lesson. We will be looking at how primates evolved into humans. This is an extremely important topic because it reminds us that we all started out as one, and regardless of race, religion, culture, and everything else, we are really not that different from our fellow humans, and we should treat them as such. For this lesson, students will need some drawing paper and drawing utensils. All are welcome and encouraged to attend. The meeting is at 12:30, and the Zoom ID can be found in the order of service. Please email me if you have any questions or concerns, and I'll put my email in the chat box. Thank you.
I would like to read this poem by Kitty O'Meara, which she wrote this year. It's very positive and perhaps wishful thinking. And the people stayed home and read books and listened and rested and exercised and made art and played games and learned new ways of being and were still and listened more deeply. Some meditated, some prayed, some danced, some met their shadows, and the people began to think differently, and the people healed. And in the absence of people living in ignorant, dangerous, mindless, and heartless ways, the earth began to heal. And when the danger passed, the people joined together again, and they grieved their losses and made new choices and dreamed new images and created new ways to live and heal the earth fully as they had been healed. This poem conveys a lovely idea about the recovery, reconstruction. I have restructured my days because of closings and cancellations. Because this was forced on me, I've probably restructured my priorities. Some things like time with my grandchildren are lost and can't be restored. but the absence of other things aren't missed at all. My hope is that after this time of change and reflection, we can become more humane as individuals and build a more humane country. It takes a lot of time, though, and I'm impatient. I will light this chalice in the hope that people, the country, and the earth can begin to heal.
Let us join together in the covenant of this church. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, and to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Each month we give to an organization that supports transformation in our community, which is the heart of our mission. In our church's historic commitment to the well-being of our community, we give 100% of our offering to those in need. UUYO's giveaway the plate recipient for August is the Christie House Emergency Shelter. The Christie House Emergency Shelter, CHESS, is the only shelter in the Valley who accepts men, women, and children without any restrictions. CHESS is open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and provides a safe place to sleep along with meals. CHESS serves over 600 people per year and turns away over 400 people a year because they are full. We attempt to place our tenants in permanent housing with a success rate of 51%, whereas the state only requires 30%. Our cost rate per night is only $26, which you can see is far cheaper than hotel costs. Due to the COVID-19, we have had to make adjustments in our space at CHESS. Only half of our normal 36 beds can be utilized. We work with the Trumbull County Housing Collaborative and utilize a hotel for women with children and the elderly. We are funded by the State of Ohio, Trumbull County Mental Health and Recovery Board, and United Way. We will now receive the offering.
Meditation.
Our reading this morning is taken from Bhagavad Gita. Arjuna said, O killer of Madhu, Krishna, how can I counterattack with arrows in battle with men like Bhisma and Drona who are worthy of my worship? It is better to live in this world by begging than to live at the cost of the lives of great souls who are my teachers. Even though they are avaricious, they are nonetheless superiors. If they are killed, our spoils will be tainted with blood. Nor do we know which is better, conquering them or being conquered by them. The sons of Dhritarashtra, whom if we killed, we should not care to live, are now standing before us on this battlefield. Now I am confused about my duty and have lost all composure because of weakness. In this condition, I am asking you to tell me clearly what is best for me. Now I am your disciple and a soul surrendered unto you. Please instruct me. I can find no means to drive away this grief which is drying up my senses. I will not be able to destroy it, even if I win an unrivaled kingdom on the earth with sovereignty like that of the demigods in heaven. Sanjaya said, having spoken thus, Arjuna, chastiser of enemies, told Krishna, Govinda, I shall not fight, and fell silent. Arjuna said, what are the symptoms of one whose consciousness is thus merged in transcendence? How does he speak? And what is his language? How does he sit? And how does he walk? The Blessed Lord said, O Partha, when a man gives up all his varieties of sense desire, which arise from mental concoction, and when his mind find satisfaction in the self alone, then he is said to be in pure transcendental consciousness. One who is not disturbed in spite of the threefold miseries, who is not elated when there is happiness, and who is free from attachment, fear, and anger, is called a sage of steady mind. He who is without attachment, who does not rejoice when he obtains good, nor lament when he obtains evil, is firmly fixed in perfect knowledge. One who is able to withdraw his senses from sense objects, as the tortoise draws his limbs within the shell, is to be understood as truly situated in knowledge. The embodied soul may be restricted from sense enjoyment, though the taste for sense objects remains, but ceasing such engagements by experiencing a higher taste, he is fixed in consciousness. The senses are so strong and impetuous, O Arjuna, that they forcibly carry away the mind even of a man of discrimination who is endeavoring to control them. One who restrains his senses and fixes his consciousness upon me is known as a man of steady intelligence. While contemplating the objects of the senses, a person develops attachment for them, and from such attachment, lust develops, and from lust, anger arises. From anger, delusion arises, and from delusion, bewilderment of memory. When memory is bewildered, intelligence is lost, and when intelligence is lost, one falls down again into the material pool. One who can control his senses by practicing the regulated principles of freedom can obtain the complete mercy of the Lord and thus become free from all attachment and aversion. For one who is so situated in the divine consciousness, the threefold miseries of material existence exist no longer. In such a happy state, one's intelligence soon becomes steady. One who is not in transcendental consciousness can have neither a controlled mind nor steady intelligence, without which there is no possibility of peace. And how can there be any happiness without peace? As a boat on the water is swept away by a strong wind, even one of the senses on which the mind focuses can carry away a man's intelligence. Therefore, O mighty armed, one whose senses are restrained from their objects is certainly of steady intelligence. What is night for all beings is the time of awakening for the self-controlled, and the time of awakening for all beings is night for the introspective sage. A person who is not disturbed by the incessant flow of desires that enter like rivers into the ocean, which is ever being filled but is always still, can alone achieve peace, and not the man who strives to satisfy such desires. A person who has given up all desires for sense gratification, who lives free from desires, who has given up all sense of proprietorship and is devoid of false ego, he alone can attain real peace. This is the way of the spiritual and godly life, after attaining which a man is not bewildered, being so situated, even at the hour of death, one can enter into the kingdom of God.
I first attended seminary hearing a quote from Reinhold Niebuhr that became popular by Cornel West, that justice is what love looks like in public. It was years later I would hear another quote, that tenderness is what love feels like in private. Part of the reason this moment is so difficult for many is because we are being asked to love both in public and in private, to exercise justice for those who are vulnerable, and to remain tender-hearted with those in our household, in our community, with our fellow church members and family. I have yet to meet a person who excels at both. this kind of public and private love. But it is exactly that kind of person that I hope to become. And that person has everything to do with how we see ourselves and the way we are asked and called to be in this world. The world is vast, and with far more going on in every single moment than we will ever know. If it is in our DNA to live 10, 20 times the average lifespan, we would still be scratching the surface of what it is to be alive and what there is to discover and grow into. With such a relatively brief lifetime, it is worth spending time thinking about the kind of person we want to become, because we don't know how much time we'll have to live into this intention. We don't know how many months or years will be afforded to us to grow into both tenderness and justice, or into words of our own choosing. One of the things I appreciate about this moment is that life feels more precious to me. My sense of awe for the everyday lives of those I come in contact with has deepened, and my appreciation that in each of us there is a great depth and compassion that is always present, even if the person themselves cannot see it. I feel like in some ways my heart and eyes have opened a little bit more, and I notice things now I never took time to notice before. I'm in awe of all that was present for all of my life, but I couldn't quite feel or give adequate attention to. And this time has forced me to slow down and notice those things. I'm in awe of a love a mother has for her child. I'm in awe of those who go to work doing tasks that each of us relies on, and not getting the proper payment or health insurance one should be owed for such a job. I'm in awe of all the ways that we collectively are becoming more sensitive to realities of tenderness and justice, and the great growing pains I witness both personally and as a community. I'm in awe that we still have the opportunity on this day to grow into who we might be while humbly accepting who we are today. Awe is not the same thing as liking or agreeing with something. There is certainly a lot about this moment that seems cold, calculated, unmerciful, and unjust. But I'm in awe of the growing ability to meet these realities with a full heart, and with an entire generation graduating high school and college, ready to apply their vigor and creativity to problems that are no longer tolerable or acceptable for us. I'm in awe of our capacity to grow past what we and our parents have done and deconstruct the house we live in, the nation, the values, our sense of self. We have been willing to reassess where we are and to see how our specific place or position contributes or hinders growth toward the kind of people we aim to become. A people that holds these values: generosity of spirit and material resources, love of self and neighbor, a worldview that inspires us as well as comforts us, a way of living that promotes health and well-being, a centering of the margins so that we can more clearly see who we really are. I have never been more resolute in my belief that this is the most important and most enlivening time to be alive in American history. As a great giant of a nation, a people full of potential for tenderness and justice, a people yearning to discover who they really are, a single individual who's on the path to discerning their true calling. All of this is more possible now on a large scale than it has ever been. A global understanding of ourselves, an understanding of ourselves in context, a re-examination of the soil that caused us to grow and become the person we've become. In the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna is at a crossroads and has reached a point of disillusionment. The life he had no longer seems to serve in the way it once did. The life he had no longer works in the moment he finds himself in. The first important attribute of this moment is that he doesn't want to be in it. It's very important to be honest with ourselves and start from this universal position. Whatever moment we're in, it is not exactly how we imagined or what we wanted. Arjuna is being asked to fight in a great battle that he knows will lead to death, possibly the death of his loved ones, mentors, family, those who have shaped him into becoming the person he has become. Like many of us today, he would rather not engage in such carnage. He would rather abstain and wait for the moment to pass and let someone with much more knowledge, experience, or aptitude take care of it. His first response, like ours perhaps, is a wariness and fear of engaging in practice beyond just talk and intellectual ideas. The importance of this text to both Hindu thought and the organization of social movements across the globe cannot be fairly calculated. It is so great. Mahatma Gandhi, the great proponent of ahimsa, or radical nonviolence, would return to this text daily as he sought a way to be fully human in the midst of great doubt and great responsibility. Gandhi, like Arjuna, had a very important question to ask. How do we be a full human being in the midst of warfare and death? How do we live by our values when we are asked to enter a situation that is about life and death? Most of us, like Arjuna, like Gandhi, would have the understandable first reaction of trying to absolve ourselves of being in such a heightened or stressful state or moment. Krishna comes to the aid of Arjuna and shows a way of being that has influenced great movement makers, including Gandhi, Martin Luther King Jr., Nelson Mandela, and many others. You have it within you to engage this precarious moment while still holding on to principles that will preserve and lift up your humanity. There is a way to be a person of action, someone who enters the battlefield of life and yet be a person of hope and peace. The advice Krishna gives Arjuna is very practical, doable, and down to earth. One of the main teachings is to give up the end game. Give up your ideas of what any action will lead to in your lifetime and beyond. Just do the action you sense is right, and do it completely, leaving no part of yourself out. Give yourself over completely to the task that is yours to do, and let it go, and trust it will take its course beyond your ability to ever know. It is a practice of complete engagement and complete surrender. Gandhi made the important discovery for his life and the life of many others that you are being summoned to engage in a great battle, a battle that is about life and death. And in that battle, it is important to lead with life, not with death. The value of ahimsa or nonviolence is not just a literal value of not killing. It is a way in itself, a way to engage and be a person of action. Lead with what you love instead of merely fighting what you hate. This was a lesson Martin Luther King Jr. learned and put into practice. Lead with what and who you love. Lead with life, your life, instead of spending your energy and waste combating what you fear or what you dislike. Save your energy and invest it in your values, not trying to rebuff the values of your foes. There is always life waiting for us to grow into it, to grow into the person that we might become. And the wonderful thing about this kind of growth is in a community like this, we help each other grow by living into our values in a way that we may never ever fully realize ourselves. I remember the first time I met someone knowingly who belonged to the Dalit caste in India. Dalit is a Hindi term meaning oppressed, suppressed, downtrodden. Another popular term for this caste is the untouchables, a group of people in the caste system who worked the dirtiest and most dangerous jobs for little pay. In our modern parlance, we would call these people essential workers. It was the first time I had met someone who told me they were not a fan of Mahatma Gandhi and that their people were left out of the narrative of a free and prosperous India. The person I met was working in New York City, interested in creating a worldview, a theology that would lift up those who were continually oppressed, suppressed, and downtrodden. His work and his life, I could tell, was more than about just a sense of justice, a sense of right and wrong, though it was definitely a part of that. He led with a tenderness. A tenderness for his mother, his uncles, his siblings, who were not afforded the same opportunities he had. Though nobody in America would notice he was a Dalit, he knew where he came from, and he pledged to make the daily life of those who grew up like him more humane and proud. Without tenderness, all of this sounds like an ideology, an intellectual idea that may be strong, but lacks full breadth and depth of what we are capable of. This month, we have been engaging the theme of reconstruction. In this country, the term reconstruction has commonly referred to the historical period following the Civil War, when the South reconstructed itself to align with the Union, A reconstruction period that, though valiant on the parts of many African Americans, was equally challenged by whites who insisted on preserving the status quo that they once knew. Though this term Reconstruction is used mostly to talk about Southerners as a group, and African Americans in particular, I think there is a personal dimension to this idea of Reconstruction that we cannot afford to overlook. Identities are never fixed or permanent. Even if we maintain the same identity over a lifetime, our relationship to that identity will change and holds the promise of transformative change. The social changes we are witnessing right now aren't just changing the larger culture. It is also changing the way that we see and relate to ourselves. It is changing the way we see and feel in our own life. But not all of these changes are left up to powers greater than ourselves. We play an important role in this change. The great battlefield of life is most acute on the ground that we are currently on. The greatest battle is not between two separate groups of people. It is between one person in a battle to understand who they really are and what they're capable of. Like our protagonist, Arjuna, the greatest battle is in deconstructing all that we take ourselves to be, all we've taken in to be by our loved ones, our mentors, our community, and deciding the next right course of action with no real idea of what the results will be. It's understandable then, like Arjuna, that we might try to mightily avoid or skip over this great battle. It is understandable we might want to distance ourselves or even downplay the importance of this great inner struggle to be the person of intention we know ourselves to be capable of being. Deconstructing, taking apart who we may think we are, is not the most difficult part. Seeing that we are more than what our parents saw in us, more than what our culture expected of us, more than what our school or employers groomed us to be. The most necessary and scary part is the reconstruction of ourselves. It is not an overnight process, and it seems to be a project ill-suited to detailed plans and expectations. The reconstruction of ourselves begins with a wholehearted action, an action taken fully, where we surrender the results. The only true possessions, according to Buddhism, are our actions. The only possessions we have in this life, the only real possessions, are our actions. We are what we do, and we are what we practice. We become the action we take. In this time of necessary bold action, let us participate and not squander our energy trying to calculate the results. Let us act wholeheartedly, remembering the pull of tenderness as we seek justice. Please pray with me. Spirit of love, we are grateful to be alive on this day and in this time. Please help us to make the most out of being alive at this time. Please help us to make the most out of being alive for ourselves, for those in our inner circle, friends, family, for those who we see who we don't know, and for those that we'll never see. Please help us to take refuge in a community, in multiple communities, so that we may feel inspired to become our best self and act with tenderness. All this we pray. Amen.
Extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we keep in our hearts until we meet again.
As you depart, please remember the one great fact. You are loved and never truly alone.